Good evening, everyone. Once again, let me add my voice to piles in welcoming all of you here this evening. Inevitably, every evening you are at Algebra, you see Pile and me on stage, but there are four other ladies in black who are your hosts. There's Nina, there's Ritu, there's Anjali and Shuli, and they add their voices to ours in welcoming you here and thanking you for coming. Some of you are new members and new guests, so I'd just like to share with you that the very intention of Algebra is embodied in the name of the club and in this dragonfly that you're going to see very often if you're part of our universe. And Algebra is not just meant to evoke the subject that frightened us all to death in our childhood, but that it really means the principle of restoration and balance. And that kind of sums up the intention with which we would like to broker conversations and open new worlds for everybody who's part of the Algebra universe. The dragonfire also signifies a transformation of perspectives through emotional and intellectual maturity. And that again is a core intention of Algebra. We don't want this to be a one-way path. Please join us in helping to create these conversations. Let us know what ideas you would like discussed here. If there are people you would like to present to fellow members, do reach out to us. We'd love this to be something that is really a two-way street. Having said that, that's our intention. Inevitably, that governs the choice of speakers that we like to present in Algebra. And today we have one such speaker who absolutely challenges the status quo. He's not just an accomplished man, he's a living legend. His poetry and cinema and scripts and oratory have moved and entertained generations. But what really makes Javed Akhtar very special is not his prodigious gifts, but his sword-like mind, which really cuts through hypocrisy and our self-deception and shifts us out of our comfort zones. Today, we are living in an era when the religious mindset, divorced from reason, has begun to hollow out our very democracy, our society, our politics, our capacity for modernity. You know, it's very easy to look at Gorakshaks and the ISIS and the Islamist Maulvis and, you know, the Jain gurus that address our parliaments stark naked, talking about how women must always subsume themselves to men, and to decry that as something that we don't vibe with. But the real question is, how much has that mindset really seeped into us? How much of it governs our own lives? How divorced are we ourselves from rationality? And how is it helping shut down the capacity for critical thinking, for individual freedom, and for democracy itself? To shift us from our comfort zones, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome poet, lyricist, scriptwriter, determined rationalist, and demolition man, Javed Akhtar. I'd like to add that I'm a willing lamb to leading myself to slaughter today. Because Javed Akhtar's sword-like mind is going to be acted upon me, being a mediator for what really are your thoughts. You know?
Before you start grilling me, let me thank everybody who's here. Thank you, very kind of you to come here and very kind of you to invite me here. And thank you very much for this kind and generous introduction. It was very flattering and very frightening because generally such praise is bestowed upon you only posthumously. Nevertheless, after hearing all this, I'm dying to hear myself. So let's start.
So, Javed Saab, I'd like to begin with something unsafe, which is the making of you. You were born into an Islamic family and culture. And today you're an absolutely unflinching, I would say almost a fundamentalist atheist. What made you an atheist? What made you reject your own culture and religion and embrace atheism?
If the question is, first of all, I'll have to explain about my parents. They are dead. Please don't be so unkind to them. They had nothing to do with Islamic culture. They were decent people. Now let's come to the point. Why I'm an atheist? The answer is very simple in three words. Because I think. That's all. You see, this Islamic culture is a total misnomer. Islam has nothing to do with culture. If Islam had anything to do with culture, you would have seen a lot of culture in Saudi Arabia. But there is no culture there, as far as I know, except for some men dancing with a sword that I have seen on TV. You see, there is Turkish culture, there is Iranian culture, there is Central Asian culture. Why it is called Islamic culture? You don't call English culture as Christian culture, or French culture as Protestant culture, and Catholic culture. These are European cultures. And same way, Islam has nothing to do with culture. As a matter of fact, I don't see any culture in their fundamentals and in their holy book.
Javed Sahib, we'll come back to the issue of Islam and Hinduism, in fact, many religions and what you think about them. Yeah. But right up front, you know, quite apart from the fact that atheism makes you think, there are spiritualists, there are others who would also claim that they think. So can you first just define for us what is rationality and why do you believe that spirituality is completely divorced from reason? And again, it's not the extremities of religion. You know, like I said, the ISIS and Bangladeshi hackers and terrorists, it's easy to denounce that. Why are you so against the place of religion and spirituality in people's lives altogether?
You see, we will talk about spirituality later, which is the second line of defense of religious people. Let's come to the front, that is religion itself, faith. What is faith? What is, and sometimes it covers even those ideologies which are ostensibly anti-religion. I am against, not only against religion, I am against this very concept of faith. What is faith? And what is the difference between faith and belief? I believe there is North Pole. I have never gone to North Pole. Would you say it is my faith? I have not seen North Pole. Is it my faith that there is a place called North Pole? Or it is my knowledge, information, and belief? There is some difference between faith and belief. I believe that there was a president in USA called Abraham Lincoln. I promise you have not seen him. But is it my faith that there was Abraham Lincoln? Or it is my information and my belief? There is a difference between belief and faith. I mean, that will be very childish to say, I believe whatever I see. That's not true. Belief is a conclusion that you have reached or accepted as a fact, a piece of information, which, according to you, there is some logic, rationale, evidence, witness, common sense that it is possible. And you know that if you want, you can confirm it by other sources. That is belief. What is faith? Faith is reaching a conclusion or accepting a dictum without any proof, evidence, witness, logic, rationale, and any possibility to prove it. Right or wrong? Now tell me, what is stupidity?
Stupidity.
Exactly the same thing. That you start believing something without all these things. What is the difference? But there is one difference. Any stupidity accepted on a mass scale is faith.
But Javed Sahib,
and that same stupidity, if it loses the following, then it becomes, that faith becomes stupidity again. You know, gods are like film stars. They are only relevant as long as they are in the market. The moment they are out of market, they are meaningless. They are of no value. There is no halo behind them. if you come to know about anybody that this is a gentleman or this lady gets up early in the morning and worships Jupiter or Zeus or any other Greek god, Bacchus, you will think this person is abnormal. This person is mad. Hercules. He worships Hercules for 2 hours every morning. But why? These were the gods who were worshipped for thousands of years. Why it is stupid and mad and eccentric to worship them today? They have lost the market.
But Javed sir, may I intervene here just a little bit to say that part of the pride of rationalists and scientists and those who is empiricism, that you can prove it, there's a provability, there's a repetibility to their assumptions. But the fact is that even science is contingent, and many scientific theories that have also, like Zeus and Hercules, lasted for many centuries, and then someone has come and overturned that thought. So, you know, you often say that it is the mind that really governs rational experience. But what if spiritual mysticism, intuition, is something that has really intuited a reality that our reason has not yet caught up with? So maybe it's an unexplored frontier. You know, are you willing to accept that?
Yes, I am, because you know there are many things. When let's take a very obvious example, when Sachin Tendulkar or Dhoni are playing and a ball is coming at the speed of 90 miles per hour from 22 yards, do they have time to ponder and think whether we should go front foot or back foot, or shall we make a late cut or hook it or whatever? They do it instinctively. And if you will ask them later, they'll sit down and think and explain why they played it like this. But at that moment, there is no time. So obviously, there's a part of your mind which reaches the conclusion very quickly, and then you sit down and ponder and think that why I reach this conclusion. So you can call it, you know, if you put the ceiling fan at the full speed, you won't be able to see the blades. But it doesn't mean there are no blades. So yes, human brain is capable of taking a leap. But it doesn't mean that there is no rationale behind it. Besides that, I mean, it's wonderful that you said that there are many scientific theories which were proved wrong. And then a new theory came, and who knows, tomorrow that theory will be proved wrong. Good. But there was a theory 1400 year old developed by an Arab, 14 year old, a tribal. That cannot be changed. That is perfect. It doesn't make any sense. That it cannot be wrong. Everything changes with time, everything with different needs, different requirements of the society. How can you say that this is the ultimate truth? Every religion believes and boasts that this is the ultimate truth. And what is interesting and ironical, that this ultimate truth cannot be analyzed and questioned and examined, because then you will hurt their sentiments.
So, Javed Saab, is your essential opposition to religion approach that it cannot be questioned, it cannot be examined? Or is it that you're saying that there is no empiricism?
So what surprises me, that you keep a driver and ask 20 questions. पहले कहाँ थे, क्या सैलरी मिलती थी, ड्यूटी कितने आर करोगे, देखो भाई हमें कभी कभी इंदौर भी जाना पड़ता है भाई कार, तुम जाओगे? यू कीप अ कुक, यू आस्क 20 क्वेश्चन, क्या क्या बना लेते हो, चाइनीज आता है? यू कीप अ गॉड विदाउट आस्किंग अ क्वेश्चन. यू मस्ट आस्क पहले कहाँ गॉड थे, वहाँ क्या मिलता था. More 99% people die in the religion which they were born. It means they have never thought about it.
So, Javed Saab, to come back to this domain of both reason and spirituality is the mind, because even the idea of God has really emanated from the human mind itself. What if even...
Kafir, you are saying this. God emanates from human mind. As a matter of fact, mind, human mind is the wall between you and the God. That is what you are told. Don't use your mind. Then what should I use? My knee? My toe? What should I use? Mind mat use karna. उसके तुम कभी नहीं समझोगे. गुरु का माइंड सुनो क्या है. इट्स अ बिग फ्रॉड.
ओके सो As I said, I'm a bit of a lamb to slaughter because, you know, I have to just pose the questions that we all secretly believe, which is, Javed Saab, even if we assume that it is the human mind that has created these stories that we live by, which we call God, would you at least accept that it's a kind of necessity that even going by Richard Dawkins, this idea of the selfish gene, maybe it is a selfish need for the gene to survive meaninglessness that we have created gods? And it has done as much good as bad. You know, as much science has created terror and evil and, you know, weapons and mass destruction and war. Similarly, yes, religion has downsides, but it also has upsides. It creates ethics, it creates morality. Will you at least concede that it is a necessary ill?
No, science, wars have nothing to do with science, or as a matter of fact, with religion also. They can be helpful, but they are not the only cause. Science makes it more efficient, that's true, but the idea of war is not based in science. Maybe to some extent it is in religion, but to some extent. But the fact remains that even if it gives you solace, it makes you happy, it is wrong. You know, if I start believing that Jean-Paul Getty was actually my grandfather, and he has built some billions which are in the bank, and by next month I'll get them. So I'll be a happy man. So you will call me mad. I mean, people, I have failed to understand. Your religions tell you, in all honesty, poor religions tell you, listen, buddy, we can't do anything for you in this world. So I'll give you an IOU, I'll give you a post-dated check, but I can't pay you here. Then you worship, you ask for the marriage of your daughter and the job of your son and so on and so forth. Wo to bichara bol raha hai, if he could get your son a job here, why would he make a heaven? Why would he make a hell? If he could punish the culprit here, he won't make a hell. He says, I will not be able to do anything about that person who has killed you, who is your oppressor, who has inflicted injustice. You wait, maybe in next life. I'll try my best. But he's saying himself, I'm helpless here. But you are insisting. God, say, ye kar do, wo kar do. Poor God. I feel so sad for him.
But Javed Saab, you didn't answer my question about imagining a world where there's no idea of religion. Because unlike, you know, you are a man who is highly educated, you have some access to concepts of science, and you've read Richard Dawkins, and you've read others. But essentially then you have to live with the idea of meaninglessness and accident. Imagine an entire humanity living with those ideas. It would be quite dangerous, because then you want to do something selfishly, you want to kill, there is nothing to stop you. At least religion creates a morality, some sense of fear.
Oh, sure.
Is that something we can do away with completely?
Now you do one thing, take the map of the world, mark the places where there is tremendous human rights violation, where there is repression, where women are treated like animals, and so on. And then put the map aside, take another world map, start marking the places where there is a lot of religion, and society is governed by religion. Believe me, you will find the marks at the same place. Religion, people are good. Most of the people are still religious. I hope next generation or the next generation will get cured. But the fact remains that people are good in spite of their religions, not because of that. All religions, each myth. Religions tell you to live every day. Of course not. Religions tell you that all humanity is good. Of course not. Every religion tells you that you are right, others are wrong. And they are heathens. They are malich. They are kafirs. Which religion tells you everybody is an equal? Nobody. Which religion says that all the ye sab rhetoric hai, all the ways go to the same destination? No. Then it's fine. Koi bhi religion, tumhara bachcha dusra religion le, why do you get upset? वो दूसरे रास्ते से, he's coming, he'll meet you there. Why are you worried? No. Your religion is good, other religion, you should tolerate. I mean, the toleration tells you that it is something to be tolerated.
Javed sir, clearly anybody who applies their mind, the idea of an anthropomorphic god, you know, Shiva or a Vishnu, who will be upset if you don't, you know, if you eat meat on such and such day, or a Christ who will be upset if you, you know, that, I mean, that's fairly an absurd idea. But what about a play of energies, you know, as much physics, and I'm flinching while I say this, because I do know what Javed sahab is going to say, but Javed sahab, it is true that we are all made up of chemicals and energy and, you know, Higgs boson and electromagnetic fields. I think the latest discovery is, as it was shown on the screen, that even our DNA is present in the solar system, and there's the idea of, you know, there was one of the British physicists who actually believed that there was an ether that ran right through the universe and joined all things. There are physicists who are looking for the theory of everything. So I'm merely putting this to you, that the great other Indian obsession is astrology. Is it possible that it is an imprecise science, but will you at least hold the idea that it is possible that electromagnetic fields of Jupiter and Saturn may indeed affect our lives? Are you willing to at least say that that is a frontier we haven't explored, but it's possible?
First of all, I must tell you that I find it rather cute when religious people try to use some pseudoscience to justify their religion and give some kind of dignity to it. It's rather cute. But the fact remains that when people get educated and develop some kind of intellectual conscience, and they believe that really, how can I believe on a talking serpent in the heaven, and a flying horse that took Muhammad to heavens, and somebody who picked up a mountain only for a herb and took it to Sri Lanka, that will be a bit too much. I mean, even if I believe, I should tell others. So let me hide behind this fog of cosmos, universe, oneness with the cosmos, and trying to find some kind of a scientific lame reason to believe that Jupiter, Shani, and Guru, and Chandrama are affecting my life. Don't be so pompous. Chandrama has no interest in your marriage or your job. And they are chemical, Jupiter is chemical, and we are also chemicals. So is Bandra, there is a locality in Bombay, that is also chemicals. Is it affecting your life? Sri Lanka is affecting your life. Madagascar, that is also chemical. Why only Jupiter is that far? Sri Lanka is nearer. What are we talking about? And do you know educated people, doctors, engineers, architects, seriously believe in all these things? This is called, you see, you cannot say it, but the fact is that it is collective mass schizophrenia. Nothing short of that. And they are not to be blamed. If you take a child and break his kneecaps, even if he becomes 25, 30, 40, he will live. He won't be able to run. Ab usse hum bole, why don't you become Usain? How can he be? It's not possible. He can't become Usain Bolt. Same way, when our children are vulnerable, when they don't have any idea what is going to happen to them, you destroy certain part of their brain. And that destruction remains forever. If you have that conviction about your religion and you believe this is a wonderful idea, have courage. Till 18, 19, don't tell anything to your child about the religion or any religion. And then tell the child, these are 10 religions in the world. Which one is best? Accept that. He will not accept any. You damage the child when the child has not. It is, as a matter of fact, people who are religious in spite of being educated have gone through child abuse. That is child abuse. When the child had no choice, you turned him into a Muslim or a Hindu or a Christian. You had no right to do that. It is like marrying your daughter at the age of 2, that this is your husband. This is banned. Now, this should also be banned. How can you decide what religion your child will take? Who are you? Who has given you this right?
Just to protect myself from being the only lamb in the slaughterhouse, will all of you who believe in astrology and astronomy raise your hands? Come on, it's more than that. Okay. That was a very untrue show of hands. I can vouch for that.
I have become so optimistic when they are asked how many people believe that the sun goes around the earth, all the hands were risen, except for Galileo. So, there are only 5-6 hands. That's great. I'm very impressed.
Javed Saab, I'm going to shift to the idea of political religion and what Hinduism and Islam and Christianity and all of that is doing to our current contemporary reality. But before that, just two questions. One is that, you know, unfortunately, there isn't a very accomplished spiritualist arguing with you. But I just, again, want to speak for the large masses of humanity that, again, it may be an imprecise experience, it may happen sometimes, but people have vouched for extremely spiritual experiences, you know, visions, intuition, exaltation. You know, people like A.R. Rahman believe that music just comes to them. You know, Ramanujan believed that maths theories just came to him. And he, in fact, could not explain them rationally, but they were proved later. So I'm just circling back for one moment to that idea that maybe the rationalists haven't caught up with the spiritualists.
Nothing comes from outside.
In fact, Einstein also said...
You take a data, first of all, I mean, it comes from an unknown place. And that unknown place, to a great extent unknown, is human brain. We know very little about human brain. So sometimes, I'll give you an example, you lose your key and you look for it. And you can't remember where you had put it. And then you are talking to me about religion. And suddenly you remember where you had kept your key. It happens to everybody.
No, but that's...
It means there is a part of your brain that was still looking for the key. It was constantly thinking. So there are different parts of the brain that keep on working and your conscious mind doesn't know that. So it throws an idea. But ultimately, the data has come from outside. And now, by using the data, the brain reaches some kind of conclusion. No person, no writer in the world starts writing in Chinese while he knows only Hindi, because it is coming from somewhere. You write in the language that you know. And there are strange phenomena, I must accept. Like idiot savants. Now, idiot savants, there are, I think, around 11 idiot savants known in this world. Idiot savant is a person who cannot even change his clothes. He drools. He can't eat himself. He's like almost a retarded person. But there is one thing that he can do like a genius. Like in Chandigarh, PGI Chandigarh, a boy was brought from a village, and he was 19, 20-year-old boy. And he was not able to change his clothes, eat himself, and so on. And wo gaon wale ne kaha, saab humara bachcha ka kuch karo. So the doctors asked him, kuch to karta hoga. Does he do anything? Does he know anything? And after a little while, one of them remembered, sir, one thing he knows. He has a calendar of 100 years in his mind. You ask, give him any date, he'll tell you the day. Now, how this idiot savant who cannot change his shirt has a calendar of 100 years in his mind, it is a mystery. But believe me, for an ignorant man like me, this wristwatch is also a mystery. I don't know how it works. And generally, it is at least twice in the day it is right. So, I don't know. But if you tell me it was grown on a tree, I won't believe it. So, there are strange phenomena which we have not been able to solve. Just the other day, rain was a strange phenomenon, flood was a strange phenomenon, diseases were strange. Mata aayi hai, mata kaise aayi hai? Because you did not know how it happened to this man. So you thought there is some spirit that is coming. We have been solving puzzles, questions, finding answers. So what is the hurry? Let's be humble and accept that there are many things which we don't know. But the religious man knows everything. Where were you before you were born? Where will you go after you die? Whatever is happening, why it is happening? So he has all the answers.
So Javed Sahib, as I said, I mean, I could question you some more, but let's leave it at that.
Tell me what is the phenomenon. Just give me an example.
We'll move to something else. I was just going to continue that idea that there are many things, like there are Greek philosophers that arrived at the idea of the atom in 500 BC. You know, they are the mandala, for instance, the spiritual mandalas we draw or our mystics have drawn, approximates the energy fields of a nucleus. How did they approximate all of that? That's merely to say that maybe they're intuiting realities which physics and science hasn't caught up with.
That's particularly in our country, it has happened so often that we have lost so much of knowledge, and because of a very, very selfish attitude, we don't record anything. We don't believe in recording things, even today. There are certain medicines, even today in Ayurveda, that if you tell an allopath, he will not believe it. He says, it's absurd. A medicine cannot be like this. This problem cannot be solved without an operation. No, it's not possible. But I know ways who do it. So there were medicine, there were mathematics, there were so many things. But you don't record it. You don't give it to others. Now, some people in Europe and America have come to know that knowledge is power. We knew 4,000 years ago. So we never shared knowledge. You know, to an extent, that here was the priest with a Bible in his hand going around from jungle to jungle and tribe to tribe. Here was the Muslim zealot sitting on a horse with Quran in his one hand and sword in another. I don't know who was here holding his reins. That's a question. And come here. The priest in India, the Brahmin said, nobody can read Vedas. He was exactly the opposite of that. He was not willing to share Vedas with others. When Shambhuk, the tribal, learned Vedas in Ramayana, the priest forced Ram to go and kill him. So we have been very careful about not sharing knowledge. And we had a developed culture. We had so many things, we had discovered, but they got lost. It has happened in Egypt to a great extent. It has happened in many societies because things were not recorded properly.
So Javed Sahib, before we move to what Hindutva and Islam and Islamists are doing to our contemporary reality, I wanted to ask you about Urdu. What impact does religion have on language? There is a sense that Urdu cannot support scientific inquiry, that it's a language of love, it's a language of spirituality and of Sufism. You write in that language. Are languages affected by religion? Does Urdu intrinsically not have a capacity to have a scientific temper? Or indeed other Indic religions, have we lost that capacity in our languages to have a scientific temper?
I must tell you about, this is my mother tongue and I'm very, very proud of this language. And it's sad that it is one of the most misunderstood languages in the world and misused in politics. This language was killed at the altar of two-nation theory. You take Greek history, Latin, even English, poetry, Sanskrit. Poetry has started with religious hymns. And then it has transcended. And then other topics, other things have come in poetry. Not in Urdu. Urdu was an agnostic, secular, liberal, anti-fundamentalism literature and poetry from day one. All the big poets of Urdu are agnostics, at least, or atheists. If Ghalib, a poet like Ghalib says, humko maloom hai jannat ki haqeeqat, lekin Dil ke behlane ko ghalib ye khayal achcha. What is he saying? What is he saying? That he doesn't believe in heaven or hell. Mir, who was even before him some 300 years, says, Nijat means moksha. Jai hai ji yani gham hota hai, dukh sa hai, mera dil isi mein, my heart gets involved in it, is bothered about it. Jai hai ji nijat ke gham mein, aisi jannat gayi jahannum mein. I can keep on reciting Urdu poetry which is against religion and against fundamentalism and the villains of Urdu ghazal. Urdu ghazal has some permanent characters like Rind. Rind means the drunkard. Drunkard is the symbol of a free thinker. Like Mehkhana is the place of free thinking, liberal ideas. Like Haram, the mosque, the reactionary and regressive center of ideas. Like Zahid, the Puritan, the wise, the preacher. Like Sheikh, the Maulvi, they are the villains. They are the villains in Urdu poetry, and all Urdu poetry has been written against them. Now this language, in 1936, a new movement had come in India. It was called Progressive Writers Movement. And it was a pan-India movement. All the languages were involved in it. And I can say it with great pride that all important Urdu poets and writers were involved in it, and they were on the front line of this movement. You take any big writer's name and you will find him that he was either a leftist or the left of the center. Like Premchand was an Urdu writer to begin with. He was a Gandhian, he was not a communist. But even if you're a Gandhian, you're on the left of the center, not right in the middle or on the right. So like Krishan Chandra, like Ismat Chukta, a forward-looking woman. When Europe did not know this word, lesbianism, she had written and justified this in 40s, and she was taken to the court for that. One of the most important female writers. Like Kuratulainada, another young woman at the age of 30, she wrote a novel which started from Gupta period and ended at the partition of India. And she wrote this novel, look at the courage of the woman while she was in Pakistan. She had to escape. She went to England, then she came to India. Then Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru gave citizenship of this country to her. Urdu literature, Urdu poetry, Sahir, Faiz, Chal, Faiz, abhi dekhi, Faiz and his family. In Pakistan, you know, good people, fair people are like humare yahan, there is a proverb, dhobi ka kutta. Dhobi ka kutta na ghar ka na ghat ka. All these people are like that. Faiz and his family in Lahore are called Indian agents because they are decent people, they are fair people. So, ye jo itna bada writer, Faiz, Firaq, Majaz, Sahir, Jansar Akhtar, Kafi, you name all the important poets, they were secular poets. Language, ye musalmano ki zaban hai. How can language belong to any religion? It is a stupid. Languages belong to regions. Tamil is the language of Tamil Nadu. Punjabi is the language of Punjab. Bengali is the language of Bengal. French is the language of France. English is the language of England. And Arabic is the language of Arab. Urdu is the language of Muslims. Turks speak Urdu. Iranians speak Urdu. And Tamilian Muslims speak Urdu. Kerala Muslims speak Urdu. And 10 crore Bengalis said, we will not be in Pakistan because we don't want to learn Urdu, our language is Bengali. I respect them for that. But in India, you see, when they were trying to prove a totally false theory of two-nation theory, Hindus and Muslims of subcontinent are not two nations. There may be some cultural difference in North Indian Hindu and North Indian Muslim, so cultural difference to bahut har ek ke hain, regional hain, usse nation thodi ban jati hain. Now they created two false histories. One history is written by Muslim fundamentalists, where every Muslim has come sitting behind Mahmoud Ghaznavi. And the other history is written by the VHP mindset, where every Muslim is an outsider, and so on and so forth. But the fact remains that they could have two versions of history. They could divide the land. But how could they divide the language, which was the living proof of a composite culture of so one nation? They could not divide verbs and nouns. Let's give verbs to Pakistanis and we'll keep the nouns.
Javed,
it had to be pushed one way.
Javed sir, we'll soon run out of time. So I just wanted to ask you, you know, in India, very few people barring, you know, there's a kind of belief that the RSS and the Hindu right are particularly propagating, which is that Hinduism is intrinsically tolerant, whereas Islam is intrinsically bigoted. What do you think about Islam and Hindutva and what is and Hinduism? Are
well,
we an intrinsically tolerant people?
Half their statement is right. I agree with them 50%. Islam is bigoted. But they are tolerant, that I don't accept. They are also bigoted. You see, any structure, social structure, that says that 30% people are untouchable and 40% or 50% people are inferior cannot be called a tolerant culture or tolerant religion. Not possible. They have created some myths about themselves. Like they are totally convinced that we are non-violent people. We are tolerant people. 2000 when Islam was not in this world, 3000 years ago, 3,500 years. In known history, India has developed two religions, Buddhism and Jainism. Both the religions have basic emphasis on non-violence. Do we agree with that? Now tell me, where do you sell umbrellas? Where do you sell overcoats? You sell umbrellas where it is raining. You sell overcoats where there is winter. Why will you sell non-violence if the society is not violent? Why will you do it? It has always been an extremely violent society. Extremely. And even today, that violence is, you have not seen the violence that is inside, seething inside people. Look at TV. When we have a choice to say, shall we be kind to this person, any X, Y, Z, or hang him, you see a bloodthirsty mob. Kill him! I have not seen, rarely you see a person with a passion. A compassion, I mean. No, we are violent people. They're repressed and a lot of violence. Look at the kind of violence we had in partition. I mean, we know about Second World War, we know about German concentration camps, but what we did to each other, civilians, people.
But Javed Sahab, that was an extraordinary time. I wanted to ask you, you know, particularly our class of people, we are undecided. As liberals, there are certain things you don't want to say because you feel you'll feed into both the bigoted camps. Certainly you don't want to call out certain things about Islam because you feel you'll be feeding in to those who bait Islam as being an intrinsically closed and violent religion. What is your criticism of that, Javed Sahab? Being from within, even as an atheist, you are from within the culture. Do you think India is ripe for the uniform civil court? Should we have it? And what would be your criticism of Islam that you would say to your own community?
In India, what you have as a Muslim personal law is totally absurd and very stupid and very unfair and very wrong. And I have been saying this not from today, and my friend, my group, we have saying in the last 20 years, maybe more.
Can all of you hear him at the
I'll
back?
A
little bit louder, Javed sir.
I was slightly scared some mullah may not hear me. Now I'll speak loud. Okay. First of all, suppose for discussion's sake, I accept that all right, we will have those laws which are Islamic. I'm not committing myself, but for discussion's sake, for a while, we'll accept it. Even then, this law is wrong. This law was made in 1937. Can we have a little more light so I see hurt, anger on faces? Can we have some light on the audience? Thank you. Was made in 1937. According to Quran, the son has two shares and the daughter has one share in the property of the family or the father. Now, this was not palatable. This was not acceptable. You see, Allah is fine everywhere, no, not in my property. So the Nawabs and the Jagirdars and Zamindars, big Nawabs, big Jagirdars, big Mazhar, who are Muslims in undivided India, they told these mullahs that, listen, don't bring Quran and Allah in this matter. They very obediently accepted that, because church generally accepts what the ruler says, the rich man says, and the rich man always uses the church. This is the history. In Muslim personal law, which stands even today, the daughter is deprived of agricultural property of the father, which is totally against Quran. First of all, what is wrong that why one third? Chalo, that is another discussion, because I don't accept even that. But even that smaller share is denied to the daughter in Muslim personal law, and shame on these mullahs that from 1937 till today, their Islam was in danger when you were giving 140 rupees to an old 70-year-old woman. But Islam is not in danger by denying so many daughters for so many years their rightful share in the property.
And Javed Sahib, you've said that even in Pakistan, they don't follow.
The fact is this, talak, talak, talak. Again, I'll speak from the point of view of their religion. Even in Quran, it is not allowed. This practice developed later. It is not allowed. It's a shame for us. We call ourselves a secular country. It is not allowed in Pakistan and Bangladesh and even Saudi Arabia. But it is allowed in India, because otherwise Islam will be in khatre mein aa jayega. You see, this is a totally a fraud. And this is the ego of the fundamentalist and his assertion that is about us. And average Muslim doesn't even know about it. Some 15 years back, I made a group, went to different cities in North India, from city to city, and we had meetings in those areas where it was pockets of Muslims. And some 2-3 persons would stand up and oppose us. Then we'll show them. They got panicky because the crowd was surprised and agreeing with us. They didn't know that. You see, the words are such, Muslim personal, acha lagta hai, Muslim personal hai. Law kya hai, nahi malum. So,
Javed Sahib, you know, we'll have to open this up for questions because we're going to run out of time. I'll just point to a couple of things that Javed Sahib has wanted to talk about. One, indeed, I would have liked to ask him that in Parliament, he stood up and said that we should say Bharat Mata Ki Jai. And I think that's another kind of religion, this hyper-nationalism that we are all falling prey to. And I, for one, don't want to say Bharat Mata Ki Jai, not because I don't love this country, but I'd like to have the freedom to criticize it. And also, I object to the iconography of this country being Hinduized, not because I'm not a proud Hindu, but I don't want to posit that on others. So, Javed Sahib, if you have time, I'd like you to speak about that. Javed Sahib also wanted to talk about cinema and how our society is hypocritical and our cinema is reflecting that about us. But I don't want to hog all his time, so I'd like to open this up to you, and if we have 2-3 minutes at the end, then we'll try and address those questions. And of course, Javed Sahib also has other criticisms of Islam that very often we liberals don't have the courage to speak out, and we certainly hand that territory over to the Hindu right. So it is very refreshing that someone as educated and committedly liberal as Javed Sahib has the courage to speak of those things to his own community and about his own community. So I leave that just as strands of conversation that we haven't had time to explore, and let's open this up.
So this was the promo of what I think.
Yes, sir. So, okay. Pile this, somebody right here. I'd ask you all to keep it very short, just because we have, you know, more left in the evening.
Javed Saab, thank you very much for your excellent talk. We have heard you, seen you through various films, on talk shows and all, and we all are, I think, without exception, your admirers. So thank you very much for that, firstly. Secondly, my question is regarding Sufi Islam. People say that that Islam, Salafi and others, Wahhab, that is not so good. I'm saying in simple terms so as not to take much time. But people say that Sufi Islam is good and we enjoy their music, their whatever they say. So can you just reflect on that aspect, Sufi Islam?
Well, ostensibly it seems to be harmful and a kind of a romantic idea. And harmless and romantic idea. And if it gives you any pleasure and if you feel better, go and indulge in it. There's no problem. But you see, this word mola is coming out of my ears now. Every second song has mola, mola, mola. I want censor board to ban this word mola for at least 10 years. But it is some kind of a diluted version. You know what happens that you know, when you stop drinking whiskey, you say, "Abhi to main kabhi kabhi red wine ya beer le leta hoon." So okay, you can do that.
Yes. First you and then you. Yeah.
Javed ji, India is a secular country and the constitution guarantees secularity. Why don't you think that atheism also should be one of the recognized religions in this country and there should be space for them?
Of course it should be. You have so many religious channels. You have Hindu religious channels and Muslim religious channels and Christian religious channels and Sikh religious channels. I mean, look at this. Why can't we have one channel of atheists? If you want to listen to what atheists have to say, put the channel on. Otherwise, don't. But if an atheist says something, that is very disturbing. You know, whatever you cannot defend by logic, reason, rationality, you have to defend it with sentiments. Everybody's sentiment gets hurt. Why your rationality doesn't get hurt, you're not bothered.
That's well said. There are a lot of entrepreneurs here. Javed Saab is primed to start a Jadu Akhtar channel, you know, so, and that will be the first channel of conversion to atheism. So, last question and then we'll close. Second last. Yes.
Javed Saab, I have no dispute with what you said. Brilliant. I admire you for saying that and speaking. Not too many people go in a forum like this and talk like this. How do you, in your mind, explain somebody's born, like to use your example, as Hussein Bolt, and a kid born in the gutter with broken kneecaps?
You see, the problem is not all of us. We take ourselves a bit too seriously. We are a bit too pompous. You see, we think why it has happened to me, why it has happened to him, why this child was born here, why he was born there, why he had cancer, why she died so young, why this man is so successful. All whys are for us. Do we ever think why this mosquito was born? Why this cockroach was born? What this cockroach is doing? And when I have killed this cockroach, where this cockroach has gone? To hell or to heaven? This is a, think of a blade of grass. Why this blade of grass is near the wall where there is no sunlight, so it goes yellow very soon, doesn't get chlorophyll. Why this blade of grass is in the center of the lawn and it's healthier? Why? It's all random. Let's accept it. It's random. I mean, I saw a film on Discovery Channel. And it was a very interesting film where with some infrared camera, they had shown the sperms traveling in the tube and reaching the egg. Believe me, I am not saying it for the effect. I got tears in my eyes. it made me feel so humble. Can you imagine a billion sperms traveling and getting eliminated, and just by chance, those 7, 8, 9 sperms that have reached the ovary, one of them gets stuck to an egg. That is how upset all of us are.
I think that's a wonderful note of rationality and absurdity to end on. I know there are many questions. I myself have many, many more. But as I said, Javed Saab is the provocateur, you know, par excellence. You cannot be half an hour in his presence and not question every dearly held belief that you have. And we haven't even begun to unravel the kind of stupidities, to use his most favorite phrase, that we surround ourselves with. He's merely nicked our skin, but he's available with us for the rest of the evening to have more conversations with. And we're going to stop now for half an hour, refill your drinks, accost Javed Saab, and then we'll come back for another absolutely mesmerizing session with somebody that I can vouch none of you have ever met, for glimpses into an aspect of India that, again, I can vouch pretty much none of you would have had access to. So see you back in half an hour. And thank you very much. Thank you, Javed Saab. Next is an encounter with somebody that, as I said, gives a glimpse into an India that we can barely recognize. Before I introduce you to her and introduce the world that she occupies and has been resisting, not just for herself, not just for her state, but for indeed all of us to fight for a kind of society that we do want to live in. Before I do that, I'm going to ask Javed Saab to come back on stage just for 2 minutes to recite a poem that reflects the tenor and fabric of our times. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Javed Saab back just for 2 minutes.
This is like Phantom Strikes Again. This is a poem that I have written recently. Naya Hukum Nama, means the new ordinance. One believes that languages are for communication, beside many other things, but the prime service that a language should offer is communication, that I should be able to communicate what I'm saying to you. If it fails that purpose, then it may be the best language in the world, but it is useless in a way. So, main jahan tak ho sakta hai, I try to keep my language as simple, as transparent as possible. But in spite of that, sometimes it becomes unavoidable to use a word which is not very commonly used or which is very familiar with everybody. Everybody finds it familiar. So, aisa koi word aapko lage, ek do to mujhe hi lagte hain, so I'll immediately translate them. And agar aapko lage, to aap, you raise your hand, you won't be disturbing me. As a matter of fact, it will be a confirmation that you are hearing the poem. नया हुक्मनामा किसी का हुक्म है सारी हवाएं हमेशा चलने से पहले बताएं कि उनकी सिमत क्या है डायरेक्शन हवाओं को बताना ये भी होगा चलेंगी जब तो क्या रफ्तार होगी कि आंधी की इजाजत अब नहीं है हमारी रेत की ये सब फसीलें वॉल्स ये कागज के महल जो बन रहे हैं हिफाजत इनकी करना है जरूरी और आंधी है पुरानी इनकी दुश्मन ये सभी जानते हैं किसी का हुक्म है दरिया की लहरें जरा ये सरकशी एरोगेंस जरा ये सरकशी कम कर लें अपनी हद में ठहरें उभरना फिर बिखरना और बिखर कर फिर उभरना गलत है उनका ये हंगामा करना ये सब है sirf vashat ki alamat, symbol of obsessive attitude. Ye sirf ye sab hai sirf vashat ki alamat, bagawat ki alamat. Bagawat to nahi bardasht hogi, ye aadat to nahi bardasht hogi. Agar leharon ko hai darya mein rehna, to unko hoga ab chupchap behna. Kisi ji sarkashi maine kaha arrogance, ek arrogant attitude. You thought it is a title, sarkashi. Mr. Kashi got this title. Kisi ka hukm hai ab gulsita mein. Gulsita, garden. Mehaz means keval, only. Kisi ka hukm hai ab gulsita mein. Mehaz ek rang ke hi phool honge. Kuch afsar honge jo ye tay karenge. Gulistan kaisa banna hai ye kal ka. Yakinan phool ek rangi to honge, magar ye rang hoga kitna gehra, kitna halka, ye afsar tay karenge. Kisi ko koi ye kaise bataye? Gulistan to kabhi ek rang ke hote nahi hai, kabhi ho hi nahi sakte. Ki har ek rang mein chupkar bahut se rang rehte hain. Jinhone baagh ek rangi banana chahe the, unko zara dekho ki jab ek rang mein 100 rang zahir ho gaye hain to wo ab kitne pareshan hain, wo kitne tang rehte hain. Kisi ko koi ye kaise bataye? Hawaein aur lehre kab kisi ki baat sunti hain? Hawaein hakimon ki muthiyon mein, hathkadi mein, कैद खानों में नहीं रुकती. ये लहरें जब कोई रोके तो दरिया कितना हो पुरसुकून, पुरसुकून शांत और बेताब मींस रेस्टलेस, तो दरिया कितना भी हो पुरसुकून बेताब होता है. और इस बेताबी का अगला कदम सैलाब होता है. सैलाब मींस फ्लड. तो दरिया कितना भी हो पुरसुकून बेताब होता है, और इस बेताबी का अगला कदम सैलाब होता है. किसी को कोई ये कैसे बताए?
थैंक यू.